The Who.
As long as there has been music, there has been musicians, and it seems as though these musicians are drawn to a certain lifestyle. Many superstars have come and gone, lived and died, under the effects of substance abuse. Heroin, cocaine, marijuana, acid, and the rest. What are the motives behind their choices? Let's explore four examples and find out their stories.
Robert Nesta Marley was born on February 6, 1945, in Nine Mile, Jamaica. At a very young age, Robert dealt with a lot of discrimination and rejection from his peers. He was known as the half-caste boy with a black mother and a white father who left the family. Based on its Ethiopian roots, the town of Nine Mile was very musical, and Bob started singing at a very young age. With help from one of his only friends, Peter Tosh, Bob learned the guitar and wrote his very first song, Judge Not. As Robert grew older, him and his mother moved to Kingston in search of a more fulfilling life. They lived in poverty in Trenchtown, the slums of Kingston. Still friends, Robert and Peter continued writing music along with Neville Livingston. During a musical revolution in Jamaica, after the country gained its independence, they searched for a true Jamaican sound that would become known as ska and later reggae. Three guys became known as the Wailers and recorded their first single together, Simmer Down. Following his mother, Bob moved to the United States for a short period of time before he planned on moving back to Jamaica. Being fed up with how the record companies would overwork him and underpay him, Bob had planned on separating and starting his own act and record label. Little did he know, when he would move back to Jamaica, he would not just change his career, but entire personal beliefs. While Marley was in America, a living God visited Jamaica and changed the lives of many. Haile Selassie I was seen as the second coming of Jesus to a small group known as the Rastafarians, a black liberation religion named after the Emperor Selassie. Through many prophets and the Bible, the Rastafari were taught of a prophecy that said to look toward the throne for a black king who would come as the Messiah. When Marley moved back to Jamaica, he found himself surrounded by the excitement of the Emperor's recent visit. Bob grew more interested, as his friends would tell him even more and more about what was going on. We will now hear from one of Marley's friends about how Bob became involved with the religion.
Not until Bob Marley, no, become a Rasta and use reggae music as a vehicle to spread the word of Rasta internationally, that Rasta became international. I was the one who cultured Rita Marley, Bonnie Wailers, Peter Touch, when Bob was in Delaware. When Bob came back from Delaware, they bring Bob to me, and he got a bit of the culture also. When I first introduced Bob to Mortimer Planner, the first thing that Mortimer tried to do was to get him to be independent in the music fraternity, so as not to depend on the producers who would exploit entertainers in those days.
The religion is very spiritual and involves self-enlightenment. The use of marijuana, which is also known as herb, is said to be a sacrament for the Rastafari and used for spiritual meditation. Here we can learn from a Rastafari himself about the use of herb.
The herb plant is a plant where it has been proven to enhance creativity and to encourage and stimulate discussion and thought. So I and I use the plant really, you know, as a spiritual gift that comes from God, where it was given to Solomon, well, given to I and I after Solomon, because elders have taught us that the plant really spawned from King Solomon's grave, and history has shown King Solomon to be the wisest of all men. So we see the herb plant as the weed of wisdom, you know? Herb is not as a thing where it's like a hardcore drug, you know? You should be worrying about those things, those drugs that they create, not the plant that God gave us.
Herb is the healing of the nation. You see, when I smoke herb, and I get inspiration, strong inspiration, because, you see, it's a form of some people that say sacrament, you know. So, I sacrament, make it as a sacrifice within myself, you know, spiritually, you know. Holy Emmanuel Eyes, last Rastafari.
Before you write a song, you burn a spliff, then you go run so you can lively up yourself, and then you get more inspired so the lyrics can come out.
Robert Nesta Marley died of melanoma on May 11th, 1981. Born on August 1st, 1942, in San Francisco, Jerry Garcia was raised to be a musician. His parents were both musicians, especially his father, who directed his very own jazz orchestra. Jerry's music experience started on the piano at a very young age. By the time he was 15, he was inspired to play the guitar, like rock and roll pioneers such as B.B. King, Ray Charles, and even Chuck Berry. Being a teen in San Francisco during the late 50s and early 60s, Jerry Garcia was in the center of the peace movement. As he met other hippies, they formed a band known as the Warlocks. As time passed, and the band was playing bars and clubs, they found that another band was using the same name. Upon opening a dictionary, bassist Phil Lesh's eyes settled on a term, and the Grateful Dead was born. Thank you. From the band's humble beginnings, it was almost as if Marijuana was a band member itself. There's little information about how the band was introduced to the drug, other than that it was a part of the scene. Two friends of the band, Robert Hunter and Ken Kesey, were test subjects for LSD in a lab at Stanford. Ken Kesey got a hold of some acid. As it was still legal, he started to throw parties that became known as the acid tests. The Grateful Dead were first introduced to LSD when they were asked to play an acid test after a Stones concert in December of 1965. Jerry stated that he loved the acid test gigs because they were free to play what and when they wanted. He claims they were magic. The Grateful Dead were introduced to many forms and types of drugs. The band has a reputation, and when people hear the name The Grateful Dead, they immediately think of drugs. The band is famous for it, so much so that the fans have been dubbed Deadheads. Unfortunately, the band member who dealt with the worst of the addictions was Jerry. After Jerry was introduced to a smokable form of heroin, he battled an addiction with it for many years. Very little about the addiction was talked about, or even published about in interviews until he entered rehab. Through a couple of interviews with Rolling Stone magazine, we can gain a small insight into his drug experience. Jerry believed his experience was very positive. He stated that psychedelics showed him many universes. He did, however, say that it affected his performance as a musician. Stating he had a very addictive personality, he wished there was a way to use the dead-end drugs such as cocaine and heroin without them controlling his personality. A famous quote of Jerry, "I don't think there's anything else in life, apart from a near-death experience, that shows you how extensive the mind is." With a cigarette addiction, constant struggle with other drugs, his weight, and diabetes, Jerry Garcia, the beloved guitarist and singer of the Grateful Dead, died of a heart attack while in rehab in August of 1995. In part one, we learned that drug use can come from religion, inspiration, and fun. As we move 30 years later to the 1990s, musicians put a new spin on substance abuse.
Kurt Cobain was born in the small town of Aberdeen, Washington. He began to show his musical talents at an early age, and he was strongly encouraged by his aunt, who happened to be a professional artist. His Aunt Mary reports him singing at only 2 years old. Kurt experienced a significant change in his life at age 7 when his parents divorced. His mother noticed that his personality was different after the event. He was no longer the happy-go-lucky child that he once was. He strongly disliked his new step-parents and wanted his family back. Next, he began to get bullied in school. The other kids called him gay, but eventually he stopped caring. He dropped out of high school and left home, occasionally staying with friends. He traveled up to Olympia whenever he could to see rock bands play. There he met and befriended bassist Chris Novoselic and convinced him to be in his new band, Nirvana. Their first album, Bleach, did not have much commercial success. But in 1991, they released Nevermind, which contained the song that popularized grunge, Smells Like Teen Spirit. Nevermind began a movement that quickly swept the country, and Kurt became the leader of a generation. Because he had a hatred for pretty much everyone, he despised the media and all the attention that Nirvana was getting because of Nevermind. He felt that the media persecuted him and hated that so much was expected of him.
I don't know, I just noticed that people expect expect more of a thematic angle with our music. You know, they always want to read into it. And before, I was just using pieces of poetry and just garbage, you know, just stuff that just would spew out of me at the time. And a lot of times when I write lyrics, it's just at the last second because I'm really lazy. So, and then I find myself having to come up with explanations for it, you know. So I thought I'd, you know, prevent that this time and actually have an explanation for some of the songs at least.
Kurt Cobain's famous heroin addiction most likely began around 1986. He did heroin occasionally until 1990, when his usage became more serious. Kurt claims that the reason he started using heroin was to deal with intense stomach pains. His addiction slowly worsened. He made a few attempts at rehab, but none of them were a success. On his next tour, Cobain was diagnosed with bronchitis and laryngitis. He took a break from the tour and flew to Rome for medical treatment. There, he overdosed, fell into a coma, and stayed in the hospital for 5 days. He returned home for some time until he had gone missing in early April 1994. On April 8th, his body was found in his home, with a shotgun wound to the head. There was a note in which Cobain said that he began to hate everyone after his parents divorced, and that he had enough of his life. There are various conspiracies out there about the death of Kurt Cobain, but we are unsure of what is true and what is just a rumor. Everything in Kurt's past is a factor in the person that he grew up to be, and his impact on the world will never be forgotten. In the late 80s, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, a new rock-funk band, burst onto the scene. With the drug overdose-related death of their first guitarist, Hillel Slovak, John Frusciante saw an opportunity to audition for his favorite band. He idolized Slovak and made sure to learn all of his guitar parts. The Chili Peppers welcomed him in at age 18, which made John more excited than he had ever been before. They began work on their next two albums, which produced hits such as Under the Bridge and Give It Away. As the group quickly grew in popularity, John was overwhelmed. He was already using illegal drugs at the time, due to influence from his bandmates, but in 1992 he refused to go on stage to play a show in Japan. He was eventually convinced to perform, but he flew back to California the next day, in the middle of the tour. He quit the band and spiraled into madness and a deep depression. His use of heroin and cocaine took over his life, and he rarely left his house in Hollywood. Here in an interview in Frusciante's house, he explains exactly what was going through his mind at the time.
When I joined the band, I couldn't believe that they, like, wanted to be this other thing than they were, you know? Like, they didn't think, like, I thought of them as huge stars, you know? But to them, they weren't famous yet, you know, and they hadn't made it yet, and they wanted to be as big as Aerosmith or whatever, you know? And I couldn't, like, that was a shock, yeah. But it didn't bother me, I was happy as hell. But I hoped that we would stay at the level that we were at in popularity.
The demands of the music industry were too much for John to handle.
So the real shock came when I found out that this record that we had been recording this music that me and Flea had just gone nuts over for, you know, a few months was actually going to be in record stores and be there would be a bunch of people going and buying it and then putting it on and listening to that music that we made. It had never occurred to me, literally, I'm serious. It had never entered my head. It was never a thought that went through my head that said, people are going to buy this and listen to it. A lot of people all over the world. Like when I first said it, I said all over the country. And then I realized, Jesus, all over the world. And I said it to Flea like five different ways. And he was going, yeah, yeah. And like, I was just like, just do writing of all kinds, movie scripts, idea, just stuff off the top of my head, like mathematics, all sorts of things. Hailing around you has nothing to do with those snakes and flakes they take we get to live. They think they're that, we think they're that. Are we just came from a red
John Frusciante had completely lost his mind. An article published in 1996 in the Phoenix New Times described Frusciante's present state. His teeth are nearly gone now. His lips are pale and dry. His hair is shorn to the skull. His fingernails, or the spaces where they used to be, are blackened by blood. He likes the way his body appears, a skeleton covered in thin skin. The consensus was that Frusciante had died. Nobody had seen him in a long period of time, and his home smelled of death. His addictions had taken a massive toll on his body, and his friends had abandoned him. John's depression was so extreme that he was surprisingly okay with the condition that he was in. He spent most of his time writing and recording, but his music is haunting. It is truly his inner demons come to life.
If you're a musician, you're either going to become a cool person, or you're going to become, like, you're going to become a good nothing. You're going to know how to be nothing and really understand it, or you're going to be a bad nothing and just a piece of shit. And there's not really any in between if you're a rock star, you know? Okay, you want me to say something soulful? Drugs, I'm a junkie and I love shooting up and that means I'm self-destructive and it doesn't destroy my body. I feel great. If I didn't feel great, I'd change the way I live. I'd start running or something. I feel great. Have lots of energy. I'm writing all the time, writing music all the time. Developing my brain.
A few years later, John's house was destroyed in a fire. He barely escaped, but sadly, all of his belongings, including his guitar collection, were lost. At that point, Frusciante decided that he had had enough, and that it was time to turn his life around. In lead singer Anthony Kiedis' autobiography, Scar Tissue, he describes what John went through. In 1997, he checked into Las Encinas, a rehab center in Pasadena. He quit heroin cold turkey, but was diagnosed with several infections. His rotten teeth were removed and replaced. He also received skin grafts to fix the wounds on his arms from improperly shooting heroin. A month later, after pretty much having his entire body reconstructed, he left rehab as a new man. He was free of his ailments and demons and began to live a much healthier life. Anthony, Flea, and Chad happily accepted John back into the Red Hot Chili Peppers in 1998, and they went on to record three more albums together, one in 1999, 2002, and 2006. In 2009, he announced that he would leave the band once again to work on his solo career and more experimental music. He is still alive and well today. And you come to me on the summer breeze, keep me warm in your love, and you softly, and it's me you need to show.
Breaking us down when they all shoot.
In part two, we learn that drug use can also come from depression, anxiety, and the struggle with fame.
People blame the music. That isn't the reason. When we started our research, we didn't have a point to make. We wanted to see how these musicians, who are famous for their drug abuse, got into their habits. We noticed along the way that they were all influenced by something. It all comes from their culture, their religion, the people around them, from the hippies to the angst of the 90s teens. The fan base does not pick the musician, but the musicians were born of the culture. Thank you for watching.